purpose this word for, that our lives be transformed to the glory of your name. Open up our eyes, open up our hearts, that we may behold all the great things that is found in your word. Touch us, O Lord. Be our teacher this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
So the last time that I was here, we talked about Ephesians 1. And I don't know if you remember, but we talked about how the Father, the Son, and the Spirit all work together to bring about salvation in Christ. So he said that the Father chose us before the foundation of the earth. And Christ died for our sins, and the Holy Spirit sealed us. So today we're going to go through chapter 2, which our brother just read for us. But I'll read it again. So Ephesians 2, 1 to 10. And it said, "And you he made alive, who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in sons of disobedience, and among whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, just as others. But God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love, which he loves us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up together, and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and not of yourself. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." Amen?
Amen.
So maybe after hearing all the promises and the goodness of what God has done for you, you may want to go out and think you deserve it. So right after, Paul is prayed for the Ephesians that their eyes may open so they may understand and receive all the blessings that God has for them in the heavenlies. He tells them that you are dead in your trespasses and sins. And the reason why he might be saying that is from 11 downward, it talked about so there were some Jew Christians which kind of had circumcision, which was something that was instituted in the Old Testament as a requirement for salvation in Christ. So Paul is trying to say that apart from the cross of Christ, there is nothing else that can be added. And from 2 to 10, we'll go through stepwise what we were, what is it that Christ has done for us, and how he's using us for his own good works. Amen? So verse 1, he said, "You were dead, and he made alive." So dead in the sense that, in regards to God, there is no way you would have come close to God. There is no way that you had any sensibility of even the existence of God. You might have heard of God, but it wasn't even in the forefront of your mind. So by nature, what your natural tendencies were was all evil. So, and this is very important because, I don't know, like, I think this year is the 500th year of the Reformation, and the main key theme of the whole, I don't know if you know, through church history, Luther, all of them was salvation by grace alone, through faith alone. So salvation is just through the cross. The reason is sometimes we may see some people who are out of faith, and they might even be morally upright than we are. And we might think, oh, how come a good God cast such a person into hell or at the end of time during judgment not receive that person into heaven? But apart from Christ, everyone else is dead. You have no sensibility of God. All you can do is to sin. You have no choice but to sin. So in your trespasses and sins, it's straightforward. And if you read, it said you are dead, so it means it was past tense. Now you will be made alive. And how are you made alive? As we go from verses 4 to 7, it will talk about that. In verses 2, it said, in which you once walked, according to the course of the world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience. So, when the Bible talked, the word walk means that's how you live. That's how you conducted yourself. That's how you behave. All your behavior was skewed through your dead nature, which was in your trespasses and sins. You had no idea of the God or what it is that God expected from you. So anyone who is not a believer in Christ, their whole life, their thought life, everything is all sin. They follow their own desires, and you say it in verse 3. And he said, we all formerly lived and conducted ourselves in the lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind. So your emotions, your thoughts, your thinking was all geared towards sinning. There is no way that on your own you can come to the realization of God or Christ on the cross. There is no way until God himself light up his message in your own heart to transform you. So those or us before we came to Christ, we're all the same. So nobody here is like a super Christian than someone. We all started not knowing God, but God, through his own love, through his mercy, brought us to himself. Amen? So from 4 to 7, it talks about what God has done. Again, it said, but God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love, which he loved us, even when we're dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. And one verse that comes to mind that, although when we're yet sinners, God died for us. And exactly is also written here. That it was because of God's love for us that he came to die. It wasn't because you're any good, because you're dead in your trespasses. There is no way on your own you could have come to God, or you could have come to the knowledge of knowing him. So it's because of his rich mercy and his great love. And how did he make us alive? He made us alive with Christ. And the word together with Christ means we are co-raised with him. And he said we are seated with him in the heavenly places. And why did God do all this? And it reads in chapter verse 6 or 7, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. So the main point that I want to focus on today is actually from 8 to 10. And it's one of the well-known verses of the Bible, that is by grace that you've been saved. And I'll read it again. It says, for by grace you've been saved through faith, and not of yourself, is a gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, for good work, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. So, a little explanation. Grace, the word grace mostly is God's undeserved favor for us. So grace is God doing something for you that you can't do on your own. So when the Bible says you're saved by grace, it means in the matter of your own salvation, it was all God. Both the faith that you You needed to believe, and the grace that caused you to be saved was all God. And the word saved means you rescued, you made whole, and you conserved for an intended use. So God doesn't save us and leave us. He saved us because he has a purpose for us, that we will be equipped for good works. And he said that he prepared it beforehand, that we may walk in it. And it's not of you doing, it's a gift. So a gift, I don't know, if someone give you a gift, it's not because you deserve it. No one is deserving of a gift. That's why it's a gift. So God gave us the gift of salvation, not because we deserve it, but because of, his great love for us. And it has to be something that you think deeply about. Because if you don't understand this dynamic, then you would think that you did something to be saved, or because you think you did some good thing to be saved. And it's very important. People have died over this verse. Like, all of us would have been Catholic right now if it wasn't for Luther. And before him, a lot of people were burned to the stake because they were saying salvation is by grace alone. Because in the Catholic Church, you have to believe in Christ, but you have to pay some indulgences, you have to do some other stuff to earn this salvation. And I think the people in Ephesians also kind of believe the same thing, because there were some Jewish Christians around who were telling them, oh, just accepting Christ as a Savior is not enough. You have to be circumcised. And it's a circumcision done by flesh. And although God appointed it in the New Testament, in the Old Testament, in the New Testament, it has no bearing on your salvation. So the work of salvation is all of grace. You cannot add anything to it, and it's all God who gave it to you for free. And I think sometimes we have problems with that. You know, as human beings, we always want to earn our way. Like, we always want to add something to, like, if you know someone give you a gift, you try, oh, all right, next Christmas I'll give you something. That is our own nature. We always, kind of give and take kind of attitude. But with God, it's not like that. And it's very important that we understand the grace that God has done for us and how he brought us into Christ. Because if you don't understand that, then you go around and around always trying to do something to please God. But through Christ, he's already pleased with you, and now he's giving you the grace to live out. So you don't do to receive, you have received, so you do. And that is the main focus of the gospel of Christ. So people in the world, or people who don't know Christ, on their own cannot even fathom the love that God has for them until God opened the eyes of their heart to perceive his great love. So verse 9 says, not because of works. So are good works bad? We know all that Christians, the Bible is filled with commands over and over. Are they bad because we are saved by grace? And in Romans 6, people had issue with that and questioned Paul that, oh, so you say we saved by grace so we can go on sinning. And he said, far from it. The fact that you saved means God has given you a spirit that you are able to do good works. You're not more slave to the world, the things that you are dead in. You are now alive in Christ, in his spirit. So it's not because we are saved by grace, good works doesn't matter. It does matter, but good works does not save. That is the point you have to understand. God has saved us for good works, but a good work in itself has no bearing on our salvation. So if an argument to put to you and to think about, if your good works saves, then what is the purpose of the cross of Christ? if you can do good to earn your own way, why did Christ have to die? You cannot have Christ plus anything. Although when you're in Christ, you do good works. I don't know, is that clear? Because else even if we think we did something, we go around boasting. And it says it here. Least that you go around telling people how good I am, you know, I did this, did that, and God has saved me. So you can do the same and also be saved. But there is nothing you can do to be saved. It's all through the grace of Christ. Amen. So everything that we do, our service in church, giving, nothing can save you. Maybe back in the day, if you're a Catholic, they think if you give some money, you can save yourself, save some even dead relatives. You know, they have indulgences. You can pay, and maybe at the pearly gates, you know, Christ will let you in because you gave some money. And it's still relevant today. Not a lot of, you know, most, even a lot of Christians still think that Christ's work is not verbalized, but Christ's work is not enough. But I also want to spread, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying because of grace, you can just say, oh, I'm saved by grace, and the next day live like the devil. It won't work. Because if you transform, you are dead. And dead, the word dead means you're a corpse. The corpse have no feeling. They can't talk. They can't do anything. So that... And a picture, one picture that comes to mind is Lazarus when he was dead. And Jesus went to the tomb. And he called Lazarus out. Lazarus on his own could not get out of the grave. Jesus had to come and say, Lazarus, come out. And it's the same with our salvation. We're so dead, there was no way we could have come to Christ. But Jesus, through the Spirit, screamed out to lift it up from the dead. So if you're made alive from death, why would you think you can go back and live like you were dead? It's impossible. So if you deceiving yourself that you're a believer, but you're still living like the devil, then you have to check yourself. Right? We're not saying perfect life here. We all know we all sin every day, but we know that we growing bit by bit. It might not be as fast as you may want it, but at least you're growing and you have that sense of when you sin, you do not want to do it anymore, right? Well, unless if you enjoy your sin, then again I'll question whether you actually being saved. So it's something to think about. You can't come in a church doesn't save, but we encourage to come to church. Like the Bible, like even in Ephesians after chapter 4, it's all what commandments after, one after the other. It's necessary because God knows that your new nature has to be like that. Amen? And so it said, least any man should boast. So God does it, so there is no ground to go around boasting that you did a great thing because you're in Christ. It's all of grace. Amen? Amen? And what was the reason? He said we are his workmanship. That is, he's still working in us. So if you're saved, but you know there are still some kinks that you still haven't been able to shed yet, God is still working in you. So you're not only saved by grace, we're also kept by grace. So in our life, we have to continually, you know, work. Or allow God to, through His Spirit, to work in us. That's why we always come to church. That's why we always hear or read our word to hear all these commandments over and over. Not that, you know, sometimes it gets so hard. Like, how can we do all of this? But God is working in us. So salvation is not just something that is reserved for you in the future. It's going on now. So, you can go around and there will be testimony after testimony about people whose lives have been transformed because they're in Christ. They might not be perfect, but their life, their character, their behavior is so far away from what they used to be. Amen. So God brought us to Himself through His grace, that He would do His work in us. Okay, and said He created us to for good works. And again, the creation is God's work. And in Christ, we know we are a new creation. That means everything about us has changed. You can't go back living the same way that you did. So what does this mean? Like whenever I read a text or I read the Bible and try to explain it or understand it, I have to come back to, so what? Why is this important? Why does this have to be in the Bible? Why do we have to know this or read this? What was the reason for it? Or was it just there to, you know, put some ink on a page? But everything in the Bible has a purpose. And so we who are Christians have been saved by God alone, apart from any work or effort on our part. So God has done it all that is purpose and necessary for our salvation. So as we talked about earlier, that salvation is all of God. And in understanding that, now you will have a great appreciation for what it is that Christ did on the cross for you. Because if you think you have any contribution to it, the cross of Christ is not that effectual for you. And in understanding that all salvation is all on God, but it is received by faith. So both the salvation and the faith, both are a gift of God. A dead person has no faith. They are dead. So to be able to be made alive, God had to raise you up. And so the faith that is in you, plus the salvation that God gives you, is all a gift from Him. Amen? And faith is taking God as His word. So believing that whatever He said in His word is truth, and believing that is true, then you go and you act upon it. So now hearing that you are being saved for good works, you don't go and try to live the same way as you do. Every single day you're trying, through working with the Spirit, to make yourself available for the Spirit to keep changing you. Amen? So faith is not a gift. Faith and salvation are both a gift from God. So God commands man to believe on Jesus Christ. Man has the capacity to disobey or obey His commandment. So the gospel is a valid invitation to your faith. So if you currently always come into church and you're hearing the word of God, but you're not accepting it, that means you are moving yourself far and far away from the life of God. And if you're, quote unquote, you see yourself as a believer, but you do not want to believe or follow any commandments of God, then you're even worse than the unbeliever. Because you know the truth, but you're still not letting it affect your life. Amen? So good works are God's intent for man and the result of the saving faith in Christ. So Christ saved us so that we would do good works. And from chapter 4 to 6, it talks about all the good works. So your purpose is always to go into God's Word and try to find out what are the good works that He has prepared for you to walk in. Amen? So God has a plan for us, a specific plan of good works plotted out for us. Our place is to discover it and live it. So to put it all in statements, that salvation is an accomplished fact, and it's only through Christ. So there's no way that anyone can be saved except through Christ. And it's amazing to still see preachers of, who say they're preachers of Christ, but when you are to ask them, are people saved apart from Christ, they will be flip-flopping. saying, oh, you know, there are some good people, and maybe, no, there are no good people. They are all dead, except in Christ. And we also were dead, but through Christ we are made alive. Amen? So, salvation is through faith alone, and it's through the cross alone. And it's a gift that we receive by faith, and it's through God's unmerited favor, which is His grace, and salvation cannot be achieved by your works. And it does not originate from you. So sometimes we think maybe we heard the gospel of Christ and we accepted it. But what I can say from these, especially these two verses, was it was God who did all of that in you. And some people may say, oh, because God foresaw that you choose Him, so He gave you the opportunity to be saved. That still will put the effort on yourself. It is God who, from chapter 1, He said, before the foundation of the world, I've called you. So you are if you're a believer in Christ, you have to praise God for that fact. You are not any special than anyone out there, or any special than anyone who will be going to hell. It's because of God's love and His grace for you. That's why you are in His kingdom, nothing else. And that is the whole, I think, the whole purpose of the whole Bible, through the New Old Testament to the New, to Genesis to Revelation, is God getting a people who didn't deserve it and bringing them to grace through Him. Abraham, as an example, who is the father of faith, he was somewhere doing his own thing. He wasn't sitting down thinking, oh, I wish God would come and dine with me and save me. No, he was doing his own thing. God, through His own love for him, just went to him and brought him into His kingdom. And I always say that you can check the track record of all the men of God in the Bible from the Old Testament. You can check the track record of Abraham and the promise of God. You will see that Abraham went off tangent, doing a lot of things, David, all of them. But the promises of God never change. So, the grace, when God has spoken or God has brought you unto Him, He purposed that He will keep be on your side to bring you to the work that He has called you to. So, rest assured, if you're a believer and you feel that, you know, you've been weak, God can bring you back. Amen. Amen. Don't give up and go too deep onto the dark side. If you believe and you do that, you can still come back to Christ, but now life might be a little harder for you. So not only are we saved for an eternal glory, but we are now having some of the benefit of heaven right now. And theologians always have this, the already and the not yet. The not yet is God is still working, and already is already there for us. Amen? So, why do you need to understand this passage? What do you have to do about it after understanding that salvation is through Christ alone? How does that help you? Like in your day-to-day life, how does that help you? It protects you from the time when you have done that grievous sin that you're thinking of yourself, oh, there is no way as a believer I'm able to do this sin. Thinking that, oh, if I'm truly, truly saved, there is no way I'll be going on sinning like that. But you can bring your mind back onto this passage and telling you that your salvation is by grace and God is doing the work in you. And once you confess, it said He's faithful and just to forgive you and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. So it's a bridge to fall back on when you are at a point that you might tip over into sin. That God is always at work in you and He's bringing you to that point. So daily we have to have this going on in our minds, because we live a life and we're not perfect. You know, we get mad easily. We sin. Like some people might see us and not even think that, you know, we are believers. But The grace that has saved us is the grace that will keep working in us. Amen?
Amen.
So, knowing this truth, that we do not add anything toward our salvation, all we can do is take it as a gift of grace that God offers through His Son. Any attempts to earn our own salvation will result in being self-righteous and will be opposite of what God has planned. So we are completely dependent on Christ Jesus in our walk in Him. So we must allow God to go on working in us toward His good purposes. And we have to seek to walk so we discover the specific plan that God has for our lives. So what is the will of God for your life? In the Bible, they say it's your sanctification, that you be changed. So there is justification, so you already justified, but now you be sanctified. That is mean daily and daily, you be changed. Amen?
Amen.
So just to pull it all together, like in single words that you can take home and let it affect your life, knowing that salvation is I will use an analogy of a cake that is already baked. The cake has already been baked. You don't bring any flour, you don't bring any butter, no milk.
That's right.
It's
That's
already
right.
baked.
That's right. You don't bring
you know,
any
all
flour.
You do is come and cut in and get a peek. It's already baked for you. And it's completely from God. So you don't share in the oven, you don't do nothing. You come prepared.
He's baked.
You get cut it, and you get a piece, and you keep eating. You keep eating, and as you keep eating cake, you know you get fat.
Yes.
And as you keep eating the Word of God, as you keep feedback, sometimes my hands are moving faster than the word that I want to use. As you keep meshing with God through His Word, through coming to church, through His services, you get in fat. In fat. So if you're a believer and you're still skinny from you were before, that means you're not eating a lot of cake that God has already made.
I'm not eating a lot of cake now.
Spiritually, not physically. Yeah. Because there's no physical cake. It would be nice. Maybe in heaven we'll get to eat real cake baked from God. Amen. So just let these kind of one-liners be what you depend on. So you wake up in the morning, God has already baked a cake for you. Go dig in, eat some cake, get fat on your way to work so you can, you know, live the life that God has called you to live. Sometimes I get too frustrated with and I know I've said that over and over, that I feel that my sanctification or my change or God's work in me is very slow. Like, you know, I read the Bible, I went to Sunday school since. But still, like these little things, a little thing and I will go off. And a minute after, I'm like, where is this from? You know, and it's frustrating, but through this passage and through a lot of scriptures that I know that God will bring me over that.
Amen.
And that is the hope of the gospel, that you take one look at your sin, but you take 10 looks at the cross of Christ. So every time we look in at the cross of Christ, we look in same as in the Old Testament, as there was a snake, you know, but if you were to lift up your eyes to see that rod, then you are safe. And it's something that we keep looking up to, that we know that the cake is already baked, that we just have to make an effort daily to keep eating it, so that our lives may reflect, you know, the gospel that we say we believe. Because sometimes I feel the gospel that we say we believe or we profess, it's not evident in our lives. And it's because we've not come to a full understanding that God has already made provision for all of it, we just have to walk in it. We have to live in it. We have to conduct our lives in it. We have to think about it, our emotions, our mind, our thoughts, all have to be fused together with this gospel. And it will be a blessing not just for the future age to come, but now. If you will really be transformed and your life is in the Spirit, you won't be having a lot of problems with people. You know, worry won't be an issue. It doesn't matter whether you're sick or you're well, it won't be an issue. Because you know the promises that God has for you. It doesn't matter if you're broke or you're rich, you can still depend on this gospel. And we have so many things going on in our lives because although we say we believe, we do not trust the word of God in our lives. And it's available to us daily to implement it in our lives. So God is not content that he saves you and lets you live anyhow. Maybe sometime he may let you go to experience what it is that you left behind and see how rough that was, or how defective that was for your life. And as its own experience in life, you know, when you grow up in the church, you kind of take a lot of things for granted. That, you know, you never got to experience this, you never got to do that. And you think, and this goes for the young people. I may look young, but I'm old. I'm very old. So it goes for the young people. Don't think, oh, you're missing out because you believe in Christ. No, you're not missing out. You don't know the headaches and the heartache and the heartbreaks that people are going through because they don't know the gospel. The little things that we learn in Sunday school that, you know, we got, you know, we were not enjoying the world. It was God protecting us from a lot of things. You know, so I went to university, I'm like, oh, I don't know what this God thing is about. So, you know, I will slip out a little bit, see what is out there. And the things that people did that they enjoyed, I never enjoyed it. Like, a lot of things, I just couldn't enjoy it. It wasn't possible. Because God has given you a different taste of life. And maybe you might still force yourself through, and then you might end up in eating some pig food like the prodigal son. But God, through the knowledge that you know before, God brings you back and lets you see that his saving did not save you from nothing good. He saved you from the bad, and now in him, you have the real life. And I think as believers, every time we try so much to kind of fit our lives, to kind of let it mimic what is in the world. And most of the pulpits on a Sunday morning is all trying to influence us with what the world, people are seeking. We don't need to seek that because we have a greater treasure already made for us. So we don't need to be going after the same money that the world is going after, or the goods and the houses. That is not our aim. Our aim is that we want to be transformed through grace. And that should be our number one goal and our number one aim as believers. Our aim should not be making money. It should be just a side. And our thoughts, our minds should always be focused on Christ and his message and his blessing that he has blessed us with. Amen?
Amen.
So to end, I'll just read it again so you get it into your spirit. That is by grace that you've been saved through faith. And that not of yourself, is a gift of God. Not of work, lest anyone should boast. We are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in. And if you're here and you do not know this grace, you do not know this love, in the quietness of your own spirit, you know, talk to God. And through his grace, he might bring you also into the family. I think sometimes when an invitation is given out, it kind of seems that we are the ones giving you the ticket to know Christ, but it's through the Spirit, and it's through God that you can know Him. And it's just a formality that we do, but this in your own quietness, in your own heart. If you want to experience this love, you want to experience this grace that is unending in your own heart, pray to God about it. And if you're a believer and you feel that you're drifting away, that you pray to God through His grace that is already at work with you, will draw you back into the fold. Amen? Okay, so if you can get on that.
Close our eyes as I just pray for us this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you and we bless your name for a wonderful word, for reminding us this morning that God, it is not by any works, it's not by anything that we have done, but it's through your love and your mercy and your grace towards us that we have been saved. This morning we just count ourselves blessed that we know you, that we are not out there lost. We are so grateful for sending your only Son to come and die for us. Who are we that you are so mindful of us, God? That you have come and saved us, revealed yourself unto us, that we may know you and accept you. This morning, we, your children, we just want to say thank you. Thank you for your word that has come, that has reminded us that day to day, as we are out there, we will not be walking as if we found you. We will not boast in our strength, or we will not think that, yes, it was by our choice that we know you. But we will may be humble this morning, that when we are out there in our workplace, our school, and we see our fellow friends that are not saved, we will not boast, but we will pray for them and wish that they will get to know you and accept that gift that you have given unto us this morning. This morning, my God, we thank you and we bless you for this wonderful word. It is our heart cry that just as you have given us this gift, that our families that are out there that don't know you, our friends, our close relatives that we are friends with, that they will also get to know you and be part of this wonderful gift that you have given unto us. We thank you, our Father. And this morning I pray and I lift up every soul that is here. As your word has come, my God, that you will empower us and strengthen us, that Lord God Almighty, that we will walk in this grace. We will walk that others may see the goodness in you and that you have given unto us. That we, as we go out there, our Father, we will be the light. That others will look unto our life and be drawn unto you. We thank you and we bless you for this wonderful day. We also pray this morning, commended our brothers and sisters that could not make it. That as we have been blessed with this word, that your Spirit will also release this word unto them. We thank you and we give you all the praise. In the mighty name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Amen.